All right. I hope you like this one. My wife gave it to me. I don't know who sent it to me.
And that'd be your brother Rick.
That'd be my brother Rick. He's an avid joke sender. But it's good. It's called The Lawyer versus the Cop. A lawyer runs a stop sign and gets pulled over by a cop. He thinks that he is smarter than the cop because he is a lawyer and is certain that he has a better education than any cop. He decides to prove this to himself and have some fun at the cop's expense. The cop says, "License and registration, please." The lawyer says, "What for?" Cop says, "You didn't come to a complete stop at the stop sign." Lawyer says, "I slowed down and no one was coming." The cop says, "But you didn't come to a complete stop. License and registration, please." The lawyer says, "What's the difference?" The cop says, "The difference is you have to come to a complete stop. That's the law. License and registration, please." The lawyer says, "If you can show me the legal difference between slow down and stop, I'll give you my license and registration, and you can give me the ticket. If not, you let me go and don't give me the ticket." Cop says, "Sounds fair. Exit your vehicle, sir." The lawyer exits his vehicle. The cop takes out his baton and starts beating the tar out of the lawyer and says, "Do you want me to stop or just slow down?" Now, who's really smarter there? I don't know who's doing that. Hey, that's how they do it on Gilligan's Island, so you have the crowd laughter. So I thought that was funny. Praise the Lord. All right. We're going to pick up. I'm going to start this before I forget to start it. The young folks are released. Did they all go that are going? We're continuing a message that I've kind of been on, but it's been changing as I go through it. I started out calling it the Job Syndrome, part one, part two. And then last week, it was part three. I called it the Job Spirit, and I'm going to kind of review that a little bit. But this week, I've just entitled the message From Woe to Wow. You know, that is the difference. From woe to wow. We talked about how Job's name means cry of woe. It's one of the definitions of Job's name. And I'm going to talk to you a lot today about the Spirit. I did that last week. I'm going to review. It's been suggested to me. Make sure you review. We got to review. So it's not going to be too long, but I'm going to review and try to get a running start into where we're headed today. You know, the new covenant is amazing. What Jesus did is amazing. It really is. And you know, when we talk about Job, most theologians believe Job was the oldest book in the Bible. That one thing for sure is Job was definitely before the new covenant. And you know that song they were singing up there about Redeemer? And I know some of you have heard the Nicole C. Mullen song, "My Redeemer Lives." That's actually taken from something Job has said in Job chapter 19, verse 25, where Job said, "My Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives." But I got news for you. If you're born again, your Redeemer lives in you. Now that's good news. That's good news. Well, anyhow, let me start off with where we were last week, 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. And we'll just kind of get a running start into this. This is so, so powerful. Hallelujah. The spirit behind what people say. The spirit behind what people teach. The spirit behind. I talk about this a lot. The spirit behind. I mean, you can say something. It can even be good words. But what's the spirit behind what I say? You know, a lot of people say grace things, but law is behind what they're saying. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that was a good grace message. But then grace is not a message. Grace is the entirety of the new covenant. Amen? It's the gospel. The grace of God is the gospel. But we're going to talk about grace because I'm going to throw something at you today that might rock your world. A lot of people don't even have the correct understanding of grace, including me many times. But I'm growing, and so are you. Amen. Well, anyhow, let me tell you the spirit behind what people say and the example that I love to use. If I tell my son, "Go ahead and do it," right? I said, my words work, "Go ahead and do it." But what I said, the spirit behind what I said, the attitude behind what I said was not "go ahead and do it." Amen. It's kind of like your wife. Let me teach you guys something. If you're married and your wife, and you say, "Honey, what's wrong?" And she says nothing, that means everything. All right? "Oh, nothing." That's everything. You got that? It's exact opposite. Now you know why guys are so messed up. Now, what does that word mean anymore? Now, I'm teasing. But anyhow, therefore, having these promises, beloved. Now, there's so much we could say here. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time. We talked about therefore. The old King James says having therefore, so it's there. Whenever you see a therefore, you know this. You need to see what it's there for, which means it's connected to the preceding thought. It's connected to the verses in the preceding chapter. It says, having these promises. Now, we have these promises. And all the promises of God, 2 Corinthians 1:20, in Christ are yes and amen. To the glory of God by or through us. You know God's glory is manifested through us? Did you know that? Do you know that the fullness of God is manifested through his body, the church, according to Ephesians chapter 1? Did you know that? Amen. Amen. That's powerful. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, say, I'm beloved. The Bible says we're accepted in the beloved. You know, we've talked about this before, that when Satan tempted Jesus in Matthew chapter 4, it's also in Luke chapter 4, that right before that, the God the Father had spoke from heaven and said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And the adversary, the devil, comes to him and says, if you're the Son of God, and he deletes the word beloved. Why? Because if there's one thing the adversary does not want you and I to know is that we're beloved. We're loved. God loves you. And that's why I said just taking the communion last night and just celebrating the goodness of God, not because I deserve it, but because Jesus deserves it. Wow. Man, I'll tell you what, that'll put a spring in your step. The more you get a revelation, the more it's not just head knowledge, the more it drops in your heart, the more excited life becomes. But it says, we have these promises, beloved. And then this is where it sounds like legalism, doesn't it? Does it not sound like legalism? Let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. And remember, we talked about this last week. Let us cleanse ourselves. It sounds like I got to get my act together. Mm-hmm. You don't get your act together. If you get your act together, it's still an act, all right? We don't act. Amen? But it sounds like we have to get our life together, and that's not what it's saying. Back up to verse 14 of chapter 6, and we'll just run this. This is review. And then we're going to go into another place that we reviewed, but we're going to have new. Review and new. That's what I call it. All right. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, I've talked to you before. We think of unbelievers as just atheists and people that are vehemently against God. But really, a lot of times in Scripture, unbeliever talks about people that are pro-God but anti-Christ. They believe in God. They acknowledge the existence of God. They may be born again, but they don't believe that Jesus did it all. That's what it means to be an unbeliever. Wigglesworth used to say there's a lot of unbelieving believers. Amen? If you're born again, you're a believer. But do you believe Jesus did it all? Or do you believe you got to add to what he did? Man, this is why it's good news. I don't have to labor to get into this room. I'm already in this room. Amen. So do not, and when you think of a yoke, it's like when they yoke two oxen together. I like to tell people this, and I put it on my Facebook this week. Your weaknesses are an invitation to yoke to the strength of Jesus. When you see, Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12, he said, I glory in my weaknesses that the power of Christ, 2 Corinthians 12:9, may literally rest or tabernacle me. When you see weakness, man, glory. Praise the Lord. That's a great place for the strength of God to shine. See, we usually don't turn to him when we think we got it all together. Amen. See, this is how God wants us to walk. That's why last night when I took the communion table, particularly the communion table, when we got home, I just wanted to remind myself that when things are going good, it's not because I'm good. It's because he's good. Even, and listen, I don't measure myself by other people. Think, well, I'm pretty good. Listen, all of us in ourselves fall short, but in Christ, we're complete. Amen. That's good news. Well, I'll tell you, that's what powers you to live righteously. Anyhow, let me hurry here. So do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Next verse. And what accord hath Christ with Belial, the devil? Or what part hath he that believeth with an unbeliever? Next verse. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? Now I could say a lot here about idols. The Bible closes out the book of 1 John and it says, little children, keep yourselves from idols. Like I said before, when we partook of the communion table, Israel was blessed as long as they stayed under, as long as they didn't get into idolatry. Even though they never fulfilled the law, they were blessed because they kept their faith in the sacrifice. Do you know we're blessed just by keeping our faith in the sacrifice? But you know also, Paul said in Galatians 5:4 that Christ can become of no effect unto me if I try to be justified by the law. I've fallen from trust in him. The Bible says I've fallen from grace. We think falling from grace is when a guy runs off with his secretary. That's a result of falling from grace, but that's not falling from grace. Every time I trust in myself instead of trusting in Him, I frustrate or lay aside the grace of God, and Christ becomes of no effect to me. That's why Paul said in Galatians 2:18, I will not build again that system of justification by trusting myself and works. I will not build that again, lest I make myself a transgressor, lest I step outside the grace of God. The Bible says, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him. See, that's why the communion table is so powerful, because it's an acknowledgement that it's about Jesus. It's about what He did. You're not healed because you did everything right. You're healed because He did everything right. And that by His stripes, He took your sickness. See, that's why don't people receive? I just told you. Because they're looking at themselves instead of Him. It's never been about you. Hallelujah. All right. What agreement had the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. Say, I'm the temple of God. You know what that means? That literally in the Greek is naos. N-A-O-S in English. You know what that means? That means God lives in you. Oh, Lord, just show up. Hello. He's already here. How do you know? I walked in. You walked in. You're born again. He's in you. We say, oh God, just pour out your spirit. You hear people pray like that? That's foolishness. Yeah. Read the book of Acts, chapter 2. He poured out His spirit on the day of Pentecost. You can't find anywhere where He's taking Him back. Amen. God already poured out His spirit. Oh, you're getting ready to get rocked. I'm so excited. Hallelujah. I'm the temple of the living God. You know how I know God wants to change the world through me and through you? You got to know it for you. We're one, by the way. You know how? Because God lives in me. That's arrogant. No, that's humility. God lives in you. Christ in you is the hope of glory. You're the temple of God. In the old covenant, you had to go to the temple. In the new covenant, you are the temple. I don't have to go anywhere to meet God. He's in me. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? Hebrews 3:6. Hallelujah. How can you not have confidence when you know He'll never leave you nor forsake you? See, to most of us, that's a theory that hasn't become real to our heart. That's where we're going today. Amen. Say, I am the temple of the living God. Now watch this. As God has said, I will dwell in them and I will walk among them and I will be their God and they shall be my people. Next verse. Therefore, come out. Now, we spent time here last week. I'm going to go quick. Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. Now, this kind of confuses me because he's saying, wait a minute. Hasn't he already received me? He has. I'm a son. You're a son if you're born again. But you know, I can walk contrary to that reception. Do you know my wife's received me as her husband? But you know, even though that's a reality, that's a fact, that's a position, do you know I can walk contrary to that? Come out from among those people that are anti-marriage or whatever, Jen says, and I will receive you. Are you hearing me? Okay. It says, so come out from among them, saith the Lord. Be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch. Now, he's talking about idols. Do not touch the unclean thing. I believe he's talking about mixture, mixing the covenants. Now, watch this. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. Next verse. And I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Now, chapter 7, verse 1. That's the end of chapter 6. Therefore, he's connecting this thought, we talked about this last week, to what he just talked about. Therefore, based on what I've just said, now watch this. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, what promises? The promises of God receiving me. The promises of God receiving me. Having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all the filthiness, not only of the fleshly relationships that with people that are anti-Christ, but even with the very spirit of the way these people operate. That's what he's talking about. Leave it in context. Cleanse yourselves not only with external. Listen, if you're around people, if you're watching preachers, I'm just going to say it, and they're preaching to you mixture, turn it off. Because it'll mess you up. I told you a few weeks ago about the guy who came to me and he said, listen, you said you talked about mixture a few years ago when we talked. And he goes, now I see it. And when I stay away from my mega church, I'm not against mega churches. I think they're cool as long as they're preaching the new covenant. But he says, when I stay away from my church, I start hearing it's about Jesus. And I go back and I start having trouble hearing. Because you're subjecting yourself to mixture. Cleanse yourselves from all the filthiness, not only of those external relationships, but even of the very spirit of what these people say. I remember several years ago, one of my favorite Bible teachers, when I was just really starting to hear the new covenant, I remember the day, no more. God says, you can't listen to that anymore because it's mixture. There's death in the pot. It'll mess you up. And it was. This boy should have had the new covenant and grace in the late 1980s. Can anybody remember back that far? You know why I didn't? Because I was subjecting myself to mixture. Amen. I was subjecting myself to the wrong spirit. That's why he says, cleanse yourselves from all the filthiness, not only the fleshly external relationships, but of the very spirit. Now, this is review and new. Jump over to 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. We've been here before, but this will rock your world. I say this will rock my world. All right. Beloved, there it is again. If you're born again, you're beloved. Say, I'm beloved. Amen. Beloved. Do not believe every spirit. Now stop. We always think this is a demon spirit. This is not a demon spirit. It could be a result of the influence of a demon spirit. But he says, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits. We're to test the spirits. We're not about testing people. Amen? But we test the spirits behind what people say. That's right. But first of all, we got to know in our own relationship. Now watch this. But test the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets, now this is in the first century, have gone out into the world. Now, I wish it would say just a few. But it doesn't say that. It says many. Now watch this. Next verse. We've been on this before. This is going to get good. Watch this. This just, oh, it rocked me. By this you shall know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. Next verse. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. Now, what does this mean? I've talked about this before, but are you ready? Here's where we get new. Watch this. Any teaching that denies the humanity of Jesus Christ is under the influence of Antichrist. Notice it says that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. See, we talk about Jesus' deity and that he is God, and that's true, and that's awesome. He is God, was God, and always will be God. But you know, when he walked the earth, he did not walk the earth as God. He walked the earth as a man full of the grace of God. If you don't get that, you'll say, well, that was Jesus. I didn't believe do nothing for me. I mean, he's walked the earth as God. He walked the earth as a man full of the grace of God. Amen. Amen. See, a spirit of Antichrist will say Jesus didn't really come in the flesh. The Gnostics, I wrote this down. The Gnostics actually said, and that's what Paul was dealing with. The Gnostics declared or denied that Jesus actually became a man just like us. The Bible says he came in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. Romans 8:3. He condemned sin in the flesh. He had no sin. Amen? But see, the spirit of Antichrist denies, hear me, denies that Jesus Christ, the humanity of Jesus Christ. See, that's, watch this. Why do you think, and I've always had a problem with the traditional pictures of Jesus. You ever notice them? And see, you know, you feel like if you said a joke, he would look at you and say, that's not funny. Isn't that right? I believe that's a spirit of Antichrist. Are you hearing me? I believe with everything in me, that's a spirit of Antichrist. Amen? I believe that Jesus, when he walked the earth, he was joking around. He was cutting up. He liked humor. I mean, I was sitting there thinking the other day, I think he thought this was funny. When I was at the zoo and I was looking at the one monkey, and I looked at the people next to him and I said, do you remember that one Seinfeld where Kramer had to apologize to the monkey? I think God thinks that's funny. Amen? Any teaching that denies the humanity of Jesus Christ is in the influence of Antichrist. Because if Jesus did not, I wrote some things down here. If Jesus did not walk the earth as a man, then what hope is there for you and I? Amen. Amen. That's the spirit of Antichrist. Let me show you some verses. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. I'm going to show you some different verses. Watch this. Philippians chapter 2. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Next verse. Who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. Next verse. but made himself of no reputation. Leave this verse up here, please. Taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. The Greek literally says that Jesus laid aside his kingly robes and put on sackcloth. Jesus identified with every temptation that you and I would ever experience. Oh, no, he didn't. He wasn't married. Hello, bride of Christ. Just a thought. He indeed, listen, we say, well, they didn't have kids, so they didn't. Listen, temptation is, there's nothing new under the sun. Jesus, I'm going to show you that here in a minute. Jesus was tempted in every single point as you and I, and he overcame not as God, but as a man full of the grace of God, even though he was God. That's what it's saying here. He laid aside all the privileges of deity and became a man. He was a sinless man. He was born again, but he had the grace of God in him, and he overcame just like you and I can overcome. Now, next verse. He made himself of no reputation, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Go to Hebrews chapter 2, or chapter 4, I'm sorry. Hebrews chapter 4, will be, 14. Hebrews 4, 14, watch this. This is powerful. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession, our profession. Next verse. For we do not have a high priest which cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. We do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. We do not have a high priest. He can't. Oh, Jesus, don't understand. He understands. He went through everything you went through and he overcame. He understands. See, the spirit of Antichrist. See, you want to know why religion operates with what I call a separation mentality? Oh, we think it's a only the clergy. We think all that foolishness. That's foolishness. That's a spirit of Antichrist. It denies the humanity of Jesus Christ. Jesus overcame just like you and I can overcome. Hold on, we're going to get to some things. Hang with me. Who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. We do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points, say all points. All points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Somebody said, oh, Jesus couldn't have succumbed to that. Then it wouldn't be a temptation. All right. He overcame everything. Oh, I'm just so depressed and all that stuff. Jesus overcame that. Jesus overcame that. Amen. Oh, you don't know. Jesus overcame all that. Hallelujah. See, the spirit of Antichrist denies his humanity and denies the fact that Jesus Christ came in the flesh and operated just like you and I can operate. Next verse. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. Keep this up here. Come boldly to the throne of grace. Let us approach God boldly to the throne of grace. Boldly. Why? Because Jesus identified with everything we go through. Well, Jesus didn't have to pay this. Jesus didn't have to. Yes, he did. He identified with everything. But see, we've got Jesus so that he was just so, when he came to the earth as a man. He laid aside all the privileges of deity and went through the exact same things that you and I go through. Therefore, he understands what you're going through. And he's right there with you. Man, I'll tell you what, that's good news. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. Now, let me say something about grace. How many have heard the definition of grace, unmerited favor? It is that, but it's a lot more than that. Grace, if you look it up, I've looked up some. I was reading in this book, and I even went and did some research on my own. The word grace means it's a divine influence upon the soul that both strengthens and empowers. Grace is a divine influence upon the soul that both strengthens and empowers. I'm going to keep saying it. Grace is a divine influence upon the soul that both strengthens and empowers. Well, I'm under grace. I'm under grace. No, you're not. You're not under grace. Because grace is a divine influence upon the soul that both strengthens and empowers. Yes, you didn't merit it. I agree. He did. We're going to say some things. So we can come boldly under the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy. Mercy's not receiving what I deserve. But if you never approach him, you know, there's a lot of Christians go through a lot of junk they don't have to. We all go through stuff because we're in a broken world. I'm not talking about that. But there's a lot of people live in a place of unbelief and they want God to come to this place. And listen, God gives you and I a choice. We can go, in the way of righteousness is life. And in that pathway, there is no death. It's not talking about right actions. It's talking about right believing. Proverbs 12:28. Let us therefore come boldly, confidently to the throne of grace, to this divine influence that strengthens and empowers me, that I may obtain mercy. And then what? I find in that atmosphere of mercy, guess what I find? Grace to help in the time of need. Amen. Man, that's good. That's good. But see, you have to understand, Jesus is touched with the feelings of your infirmities. Jesus went through every single thing that you and I go through. All right, let me go to Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5, and we'll start with verse 7. I just want to show you some of these verses. Who in the days of his flesh, this is talking about Jesus, when he had offered prayers and supplications with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death and was heard because of his godly fear. Now this is amazing. Though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. This is talking about Jesus. You mean Jesus had days when he was challenged? You know, some people think preachers just walk around and glow. They don't. In fact, the more preachers I get around, the more I'm finding out they like jokes too. If you can get them past the, I call it the preacher thing. You know, years ago I read a story about a rock band that I used to listen to, and Eddie Van Halen said, I thought that this guy was over that lead singer thing. Well, since then I've coined the phrase that preacher thing. You know what that is? Oh, forget it. Though Jesus was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. Next verse. And having been perfected. Wait a minute, I thought he was already perfect. Amen. See, the spirit of Antichrist is constantly telling you and I. That's what I call the Job spirit. Oh, I know my Redeemer lives, and someday, but your Redeemer lives in you. Right now. Hallelujah. When it's good, you can rejoice. And when it's not so good, you can rejoice. Because your Redeemer lives. And when you go through something, just remember this. You're going through it. You're not staying there. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Hallelujah. And having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation. That's not just going to heaven. That's eternal. It starts now and goes forever. Salvation is deliverance, it's preservation, it's protection from danger, it's healing, it's all those things are contained in that Greek word for salvation. Hallelujah. Glory to God. See, he overcame for you, not for him. Why would Jesus overcome the devil? Didn't he already have him overcame? Come. He overcame him for you. Hallelujah. For all who obey him. Next verse. And by God... and called by God as a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. I'm kidding. Amen. That means new covenant. Now I want to show you a couple other things before we leave this. Go to Hebrews chapter 2. We'll start with verse 14, and I'll go to the end of the chapter. I believe it's verse 18. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, render him idle, useless, unemployed. Ooh. You know why people live in fear? You know why people live in fear? Christians, I'm talking about Christians. Because they're not established in righteousness. They're not established in who they are. You know what fear is? It's an expectation of judgment. You know why I have fear? Because I'm expecting to get something that I deserve. Fear is an expectation of judgment. The reason people have fear is because they're not established in righteousness. Amen. Now this should challenge you. This is good news. God doesn't want you to fear at all. Amen. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he, Jesus himself, likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy, render him idle, useless, unemployed, who had the power of death, that is the devil. Next verse, watch this. And deliver, release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Not only physical dying, but death in all of its forms, all of its miseries. People are so stifled by fear. Have you ever heard people say, what would you do if you wasn't afraid? Amen? What would you do? The reason people don't step out even with what God's put in their heart is because of fear. It's the fear of death. What's that? The fear of failure. And we're controlled by that. Next verse. All their lifetime, they were subject to bondage. Misery. I know a lot of miserable Christians. I'm not a rocket scientist, but in my last rocket science class, something's wrong with that picture. For indeed, he does not give aid to angels. He does give aid to the seed of Abraham. That's you and I. Next verse. Therefore, in all things, somebody say all things, not some things, all things, he had to be made like his brethren. Jesus, in all things, the spirit of Antichrist denies or diminishes the humanity of Jesus Christ. It may not come out and say it, but it will subtly, it'll emphasize, sometimes, hey, gee, I take nothing away from the deity of Christ. I studied cults. I understand that they deny the deity of Christ, and we acknowledge and believe that. The scripture teaches that. But I'm telling you, when he came to the earth, he came as a man. Because he fully identified with you and I. Therefore, we can fully identify with him, and we can overcome just like he overcame. Now watch this. That he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining... I'm going to start over. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God to make propitiation. That means atoning sacrifice. It means satisfaction for the sins of the people. Next verse. Next verse. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. Go to verse, the Amplified Bible. Watch this. The Amplified Bible. Verse 18. They're good back there. For because he himself in his humanity has suffered in being tempted, tested, and tried, he is able immediately, I love this, to run to the cry of assist, relieve, hallelujah, those who are being tempted and tested and tried, and who therefore are being exposed to suffering. Because he identified, he's able to run to you immediately and help you. Isn't that good news? That is good news. If Jesus didn't fully identify with me as a human being, how do I ever expect to identify with him? And this is why people are sin conscious. This is why people don't approach God, because they somehow think God is distant and he's not. Now, jump over to Romans chapter 5. I'm going to give you some definitions here. No, I'll tell you what, Romans chapter 9, verses 30, this is amazing. Romans chapter 9 from the New King James, verses 30 through 33, I want you to see this. This is powerful. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles or the nations who did not pursue righteousness have obtained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith. Next verse. But Israel pursuing the law of righteousness has not attained to the law of righteousness. Next verse. Why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were by the works of the law. For they stumbled at that stumbling stone. That would be Jesus. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Now, people don't stumble at Jesus being their Savior. People stumble at Jesus being their righteousness. They do. You and I, we're not stumbling at Jesus being our Savior, are we? You know what we stumble at? Jesus being our righteousness. Are you hearing? That's amazing. That's amazing. Now watch this. Jump over to Romans 5, verses 20 and 21. The last two verses of Romans 5. Watch this. Oh, it gets good. Oh, it gets good. Condemnation is a result of for a believer. Condemnation for a believer is a result of not being established in who you are, righteous in Christ. You know that? That's why we're condemned. That's why we're sin conscious. Because we're not fully established in who we are in Christ. This is where the Job spirit comes in. See, Job didn't have a redeemer like you and I did. In fact, Job cried out for a redeemer. This is why we fear. Job said in Job 3:25, the thing that I've greatly feared has come upon me. Job chapter 1 and verse 5, he was consistently offering burnt sacrifices. How many Christians are consistently doing things out of fear, trying to keep the judgment and wrath of God away from them, when the whole time Jesus took it? That's why you take communion, not because it's a ritual, not because you got to do it, not because it's like five Hail Marys and four, three Glory Bees. That's not why you take communion. You take communion because you're remembering what Jesus did. Yes. Period. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. God gave the law not so we could be right. He gave it actually to one nation, the Jews, but it condemned the whole world. But God didn't give a law so man could keep it and be right. He gave a law to show man he couldn't keep it. That's why it says the law entered that the offense might abound. And in the Greek, this is fascinating. Because it's a picture of if you had like a theater production up here and you have like the warm-up act, if you will, come on. The law entered to do its thing for a short while and then exited the stage. That's what it's a picture of in the Greek. But where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. Ooh, glory. So that as sin reigned in death, even so grace. Now remember what grace is. Remember what grace is. It's not just unmerited favor. It is unmerited. You didn't earn it. But grace is a divine influence upon the soul. I wrote down another definition that really, here it is. Whew. Grace is the spiritual condition, this is Thayer's, of one governed by the, grace is the spiritual condition of one governed by the power of divine grace. The spiritual condition, that's what grace is. The spiritual condition of one governed by the power of divine grace. Grace is a divine influence in the heart that does two things. It strengthens and enables. Now watch this. Grace reigns through righteousness. That word through in Greek is dia. It means through the means of. Grace reigns through the means of. The divine influence upon my soul that strengthens and empowers me, it reigns through righteousness. Now watch this. To eternal life. That word to in Greek is eis, E-I-S in English. It means motion into. Motion into. And eternal means without ages, age without end. And the word life is zoe. Zoe means God's quality of life. The same life that God has, you have available to you. But it doesn't happen. Grace, the divine influence upon my soul that strengthens and empowers me, does not reign like a king unless it's through the righteousness. Understanding that I'm righteous. Understanding that Jesus so identified with me in my sin that I'm now righteous. That I'm now righteous because of what he did. To eternal life, the same quality of life that God has through Jesus Christ our Lord. My. Jump over to 2 Corinthians 5:21. We'll look at this. This is so good. Why are we condemnation? Or why are we under condemnation? Because we're not established in our understanding of how righteous we are. There is therefore now no condemnation, Romans 8:1, to those that are in Christ Jesus. I know the rest of it, but it's not in the original. To those who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Even that, you could show that in the light of the new covenant. The word flesh has to do with self-trust. Amen? That's why it says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 3, are you so foolish you begun in the Spirit? Are you now perfected through the flesh in the old King James? The NIV says through human effort. Flesh, when most of the time in Scripture, when you see the word flesh, it's primarily talking about human effort. Human effort. Now, there are the works of the flesh, adultery, fornication, all those things. Those are a result of trusting in my human effort. Amen. Oh, I never did that. Well, did you think it? Amen. I was saying, Christian life isn't hard to live. It's impossible to live. You can't live it unless someone lives it through you. People say, I'm living for God. You're not living for God. The Bible says, be strong in the Lord in the power of his might, not be strong for the Lord. We're trying to be strong for the Lord. Ephesians 6:10. He didn't say that. He said, be strong in the Lord. If you're trying to be strong for the Lord, you're religious. And I promise you, you're falling down and you're failing. That's right. Oh, glory to God. I'll say, oh, Chris, that's all. Oh, you're splitting hairs there. I'm not splitting hairs. That's as different as day and night. That's a Grand Canyon gulf of difference right there. You're strong in him. You're not strong for him. If I could be strong for him, Jesus would only be the author of my faith and I would be the finisher. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Now, this is why I tell people all the time, Jesus didn't carry your sins. He became it. He became it. If Jesus carried your sins, then he might have dropped it. Then that's why you become his righteousness. Righteousness isn't something you do. It's who you've become if you're born again. Now, there's the fruit of righteousness. But righteousness is a state. If you're born again, righteousness is who you become. I can't lose my righteousness. I don't lose my righteousness like I'm carrying a backpack. Well, I dropped my righteousness. You see it around here anywhere? Amen? Thank God. It's because of what he did. Go back to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. Watch this. What'd I say? Verse 16. This is powerful. Romans chapter 1. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. I am not ashamed. Now, see, we always think, I used to read this and I think, well, I'm not ashamed to witness. And then I would go around trying to prove how bold I was. I would have to, well, watch this. I'm going to be with Emerson. He's a little bit shy. So I'm going to watch me witness, Emerson. I'm going with the complete stranger. You know, Jesus, man, I'm bold. Man, I'm bold. That's not what he's talking about. That's not what he's talking about. He's saying, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, of the good news about what Jesus did. Of not only, it's not only good news, it's freedom from all the effects of the negativism. I'm not ashamed of that. I'm not backing down from that. Just because people abuse things. Listen to me. People abuse everything. You'll find a perversion somewhere about what somebody's done. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation. Once again, the salvation, deliverance, healing, preservation, protection from danger. All those things are included in salvation. Did you know that? Every one of them. See, we think salvation, oh, that don't start till you die and you don't go to hell and you go to heaven. That's a part. But salvation is much more expansive than that. For everyone who believes, see, there is a requirement. There is a requirement. There is a requirement. You got to believe it. Hey, praise the Lord. To everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also the Greek. Why does it say that? Because the gospel was first given, or the law was given to the Jew. And the law, the Bible says, what profit is there of circumcision? I believe that's in Romans 2 or 3. And it says, much every way, chiefly unto them were given the oracles of God. In other words, they had the law which would have pointed them to Christ if they would have seen it in the correct measure. But they saw it as though we have to keep it. And then the Pharisees come along and they add all these additional things to the 613 commandments that are in the law. All right? But so it was, the law was given to show man he needed a Savior. I like to say it like this. You don't go up in your attic and turn the light on and say, wow, look at all the dust this light brought. No, the light merely reveals what's already there. So for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone, say everyone, everyone, who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. Next verse. For in it, in what? In the gospel. In it, the righteousness of God is revealed. In the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. In the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. In the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. From faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Faith in what? Faith in what Jesus did, in the righteousness of God. See, for a person to say, well, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ, and to continually live in sin, you don't even know the righteousness of God. Back to the two in Romans. Romans 5:21. Let's just go there quick. Romans 5:21. So that as sin reigned in death, even so, grace, the divine influence upon my soul that influences me, is me, that strengthens me, that empowers me, reigns. That word reigns means like a king. Reigns. The divine influence upon my soul that strengthens and empowers me. It reigns through righteousness, which is revealed in the gospel. It reigns through righteousness, revealed in the gospel, into eternal life. The same quality of life that God has. Now, how many think God's doing pretty good these days? Amen. Amen. I don't care what the media says. God's still doing good. And if the church would start preaching Jesus instead of what the next pope's going to be, that was intentional. Because There's all kinds of foolishness going on in the name of God. Preach Jesus. You can't go wrong with Jesus. Preach what he did. Preach his goodness. You don't have to be ignorant of world events, but the answer to world events is Jesus. They need the gospel. Most people have only heard religion. Most people have only heard commandments you have to keep, and they haven't heard the good news. Man, it's good news, not just good advice. Really good news. Man, I know you're a mess, but if you'll receive Jesus, and believer, if you'll come out from among this craziness and realize what you have, grace, the divine influence upon your soul that strengthens and empowers you, which is unmerited by you, will reign through the understanding that you're the righteousness of God, and you'll into the same quality of life that God has through Jesus Christ. Glory to God. The offense and the stumbling block is not at Jesus being Savior. The offense is at Jesus being your righteousness. That's what people are offended at. And you know why they're offended at that? Because they don't understand how much he's identified with them. Amen. That's good stuff. It's like the time I told you the story about the people. I've shared this before, but it's a powerful story. So many people in the body of Christ are not coming boldly under the throne of grace. They're not finding out who they are and what they've done because they don't understand what he's done. They're under this religious mindset. But it's like the men during the Great Depression, and they went in for the interview to get a Morse code job, you know, and they're all standing in the room, and they're waiting for their interview, and it's jam-packed. Everybody's trying to get a job, and all of a sudden, one guy just walks in. He sits there for a couple minutes. He goes in for his interview. A few minutes later, the guy doing the interview comes out and said, hey, you can all go home. We're hiring this guy. The moral of the story was the whole time there was a Morse code going on saying, if you understand this, come in for your interview. God's saying to the church, if you understand, come boldly into the throne of grace. There's no more condemnation. There's no more sin. You don't have to be sin conscious. Jesus took care of it all, past, present, future. Hallelujah. Man, that's good. Man, that's good. Now you know why when I'm standing there in the zoo looking at fish or snakes or lizards, I don't know what it was. I'm standing there and these tears just start overwhelming me. And I think, you are so good. You love me because of you and not because of me. I know what it's like to be on the treadmill of trying and never being able to measure up. Loving God with all of my heart, but never being able to measure up. Lord, when's it enough? It's only when it's Jesus that it's enough. For by one offering, Hebrews 10:14, he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. Amen. Amen. That's good news. Amen. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. How dare you and I walk around being condemned when he's done so much for us? The only way we're condemned is because I still to this day, I find myself with mindsets thinking, well, I don't know, man, I should have prayed more. I should have done this more. I didn't do this right. Listen, all that is nuts. You don't start somewhere to be complete in Christ. If you're born again, you're complete. You're in him 100%. You and Jesus are no more you and Jesus. It's Jesus and you as one. He that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. And I'm trying to stop, but I don't know how. Hallelujah. It all starts with being born again. We believe in being born again. The Bible teaches you must be born again. You must be born from above. You must come out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. Amen. And it starts with not by works of righteousness. There it is again, Titus 3:5. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, by the washing and regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. Man, God is in love with you. You know all that awaits you is blessing. The only thing that can stop you from blessing is you. Not even the devil can stop you. There's a secret. You know how defeated the devil is? He doesn't want you. He wants you to think he's so powerful. The devil. He's a wimp. I feel sorry for people on these sporting teams and they're named the Devils. You're a loser, right? You're the red losers or the blue losers. Amen. See, he wants you to think he's so powerful. He's not. The only thing that can stop you is you. That's why he says, back to where we started, come out from among them. Separate from the association, not only physically, but the very spirit of this wrong mindset that keeps you from the finished work of Christ. Hallelujah. If there's anybody here, you've never been born again, we're going to say a prayer. You got to believe it in your heart. Just because you repeat after me doesn't, you just believe it in your heart. Say, dear Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. I believe in my heart that you died for my sins, that you was raised again the third day, and I receive you now.
as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Anybody here want prayer for anything? We want to hear some more healing testimonies, so we want to pray for you. We want to lay hands on you. I guarantee you, when I lay hands on you, guaranteed. How do you know this? Not because I feel it. You know how insufficient I feel almost all the time? All the time? You know, as a preacher, you're supposed to know everything. Truth is, we don't really know anything. He knows everything. But you know, that I'm seeing that my weaknesses are an invitation for His strength. So like right now, when I feel insecure to pray for you, or when you feel insecure to pray for somebody else, that's a great time to pray. Because I'm going to glory and brag about my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So if there's anybody, before we go eat, Carol, Walt. Yep, come up here, sir. Carol, give Walt this big giant honeydew list. And just, you know, overworking him. Amen. Let's lay hands on Walt. Back. In Jesus' name, I rebuke this back pain. By the authority of the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command it to go. I order you back pain. You get out of this, man of God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Release the life of Christ. Anybody else? We're just about done. I know the food. Kelly. I'm sorry. Okay. Okay. Asthma and anxiety? In Jesus' name, I speak to asthma. I speak to anxiety. I rebuke you by the authority of the name of Jesus. You get off of Kelly right now in Jesus' name. We release the very life of Christ into her body. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Alfreda, you had something?
I need prayer.
Okay. In Jesus' name, I come against sinus conditions. I come against any negative thing here. I rebuke you. I order you to get off of Alfreda right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Anybody else? Somebody else can pray too. Go right here. It's Kathy, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Okay. Okay. In Jesus' name, I rebuke diabetes. I curse you. I command you to get off this woman of God right now in Jesus' name. I order you to get out of her body right now in Jesus' name. Release the very life of Jesus Christ into her body. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Justin. Praise God.
My ear's been giving me fits on my back a little bit.
Is that the one Anita screams at you in?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. You weren't supposed to hear that. Michael. Jesus' name, I rebuke ear problems. In Jesus' name, I command you to get off Justin right now in the name of Jesus and release the healing power of Jesus Christ into this ear. Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Don't you think the Lord's cool? I think He is, man.